Thank you, Mike, and particularly thank you very much for the illustrious title you've given to our my presentation tonight, Situational Awareness for a Rapid Response, Enabling Early Detection of Natural Disasters Through Intelligent Integrated Sensor Networks. That's what the Attentis networks are. In normal situations, this man on the left here, Cameron McKenna, would be providing this presentation. Cameron's the Managing Director of Attentis, but he's not the President of the Royal Society of Victoria, so I get to do it tonight. But there's the lab at Attentis, and turning out these little Dalek-like sensors, which do some amazing things. Let me introduce you to them to begin. There's one standing on a tripod. These can be set up and running in 2 or 3 minutes and providing a range of data. But importantly, this is a fast network. This data is collected in real time. The picture in the background is a sampling program that was undertaken with DELP doing a controlled burn just to actually see how they operate. Each of these sensors, the dome at the top, is an internal power source. In fact, it's a battery setup, which turns out to be pretty much like you'll see in a Tesla. Then there's a range of flame sensors and thermal imaging sensors. We'll see how they operate as well. They operate in 360 degrees, and again, they are sampling every 30 seconds, so this data is in real time. Then there's a camera array, 360-degree camera array, and that video is recorded. And in the internal air cavity at the base, a range of other sensors, so PM1, PM2.5, PM10, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, ammonia, as you wish, and that can be aligned and set up to do a range of different things. So it's a pretty clever device. It operates from about minus 45 degrees C to about 450 degrees centigrade. Battery pack, 21 days, backed up with solar power supply, and utilises either cellular, Wi-Fi, either of two radio networks or satellite, depending on which has the best signal to get the data out of the system. So just in summary, there's a unit on top of a standard 8.5 metre post with air quality sampling at the top. So weather information, air temperature, wind strength, direction and gusts, relative humidity and rainfall, all contemporaneously. And then a range of different air quality information from dust and fine particles. We can go down to PM0.3, so mapping allergens and pollen in different shapes and sizes, and a range of different gases. You can configure these devices in a range of different ways depending on what it is you need to know about. And detection, I haven't mentioned that yet. Apart from the cameras, there's the thermal imaging. We also can do water heights for flood warnings, structural integrity. We can measure noise and vibration, and solar irradiance, in fact. So you can actually map solar irradiance over a region with these devices as well. And soil moisture is there on the slide. You can see at the bottom right, if there was, for example, a network of low-powered LoRaWAN or Sigfox devices, IoT devices, we don't call the Attentis networks IoT, they're quite different to what's become commonly known as IoT. There's actually a chip in the device that'll pick up a low-powered network measuring, say, soil moisture in a paddock and put that data into the same network and turn up on the same dashboard. We like to think of this as providing a range of information awareness across a region. So all of those things, so it can be used for infrastructure, agriculture, fire detection. I'll give you an example of that shortly. And providing communities with awareness of what's going on around them at regional scale. And a whole range of things. So it's a scalable network. You can build these up into bigger and bigger networks. There is early notification. You can set threshold alarms for any one of these parameters. So if I wanted to know what the level of PM2.5 in a particular region exceeded, say, 250 micrograms per cubic metre at any particular time, I can set these systems to send me an alert on SMS or by email as soon as that occurs. So there's a range of different opportunities and a range of different features. And they can be quite portable. They can be fixed. I'll show you a fixed network in a moment. But they can be quite portable for specific instances and set up very quickly as well. In the space of, here's one we prepared earlier, in the Latrobe Valley in eastern Victoria, the Latrobe Valley Information Network is sitting there ready for you to have a look at lvin.org. This is a network of 44 sensors. They've been operating there since, well, for 2 years, just ticked over now. And they're sampling every 30 seconds using a range of different, particularly radio in this case, 21 days power supply. We are lucky in 2019, this network won Smart Cities of the Year in IoT Awards, Best Government IoT Project, and the Best overall IoT project in 2019, because it really is quite outstanding. You can see that there's, you can get a range of data. On the bottom right, you can see, you can just click through and see a map of temperature across the region. In this case, we're looking at wind direction. And you can see in the case where I took this snapshot of this slide, it's actually showing up some fog at a few locations in the 9 a.m. You can look at PM 2.5, PM 10, and other things. At the bottom, a new feature, you can actually do this in time-lapse. So you can actually click the time-lapse button and it'll get roll through and look at the last 12 hours of what the wind was doing in the Latrobe Valley, or PM 2.5 or PM 10 if you wish. I encourage you to go and have a play with it. It's a free network. It's been sitting there for a couple of years. Up in the top right, you'll see at any one, go and register. If you register, you'll see more. If we have a look, for example, I think I've taken one of the sites here, Rifle Range Road, from that site there. Go up and click on the enter button. But here's a little dashboard in the first instance. You can see this immediately. So you can see temperature, wind speed, wind gust at that particular location. Because it's a bit foggy there, probably it's showing high humidity. And in this case, carbon dioxide levels are 365 ppm, which is probably a bit lower than the rest of the world currently. So we look in that a bit, just click in, have a look inside the site. This is just the overview site. We can see there's live video showing up. There's the location of the site, temperature, wind speed, wind gust, etc. At the top menu there, we're looking at the overview. We can set alarms, as I mentioned, on any one of these parameters. We can flick along and have a look at rainfall. And on this particular day, there's the live rainfall recording every 30 seconds or so. And you can see that. But the value here is you're getting your PM 2.5 data at the same time as you have contemporaneous temperature or rainfall or other data. So you're getting complete environmental awareness at this site and also for the region. Looking at a different site, this one's in South Australia at an energy substation, and these are particularly useful. This is where the device's thermal capability is particularly valuable. The purple patch in the middle there, that's a thermal image, and I'll show you how that works back at Rifle Range Road in just a moment. But for sites like this, you can set this, and in fact, just for particular parts of that, I think it's about 48,000 pixels on that image, and the temperature is recorded on each of them. You can actually set a threshold alert, say, tell me when the temperature of that insulator in that switchyard there reaches, say, 85 degrees centigrade, and it'll send you an alert when that threshold is reached. So in terms of early warning, this is a really valuable tool for early warning for rainfall, for wind strength, for outbreak of ignition at any region. And the next thing you can do, there's also an analytics capability. So you can go back, as I say, and look at all this data contemporaneously. The little bit of data I've picked, this is a mine site where we have some units operating. It enables you, for example, to compare, okay, why do we see a peak on the blue graph on the right-hand side? Why do we see a peak in PM 10? Well, the wind strength dropped off. So you can actually look at situation. It gives you situational awareness. And because all of this data is recorded and kept, you can actually go back and look at what happened on the 10th of February at 3 o'clock in the afternoon if there was an incident that you somehow became aware of. And you can look at the recorded video and any other parameter that you're interested in. Just going back to Rifle Range Road, there was an incident in October last year, which is a good example of how this is invaluable for foresters, in this case, at this particular site. And that's just looking in at the this site has thermal capability. So you can see I've actually marked just one pixel. I think it says 16.5 degrees. I can move with my mouse anywhere across that screen and I can check the temperature. And I say I can set an alert when any one of those points on that image reaches a threshold level. And I've got the recorded data also for temperature across that site, and I can set alerts for all of that. On the 23rd of October last year, we actually had an alert not as an ignition alert with thermal imagery, but in fact an alert for high levels of PM 2.5 late in the afternoon. You can see what the culprit was, is that little baby fire there, but this actually happened to be across the road from the Hancock pine plantation. So we recorded the incident, let Hancock's know, and we actually had video of the incident there as well, so we actually maintained awareness. You can see PM1 level, I think that is up to 499.9. We let people know. We actually also had the video here. As we just roll through it, it takes a minute or so, but it was the high levels of PM 2.5 late in the day that alerted us. We had an alert set for this particular site, and you can see it gets very smoky in just a few seconds. And that, in fact, we're able to alert the people at Hancock. There you go, there's all the smoke. We're able to alert people at Hancock's and the CFA, and we managed to ensure that a very valuable pine plantation across the road didn't catch fire because of that unattended fire late in, I think it was a Friday afternoon, which otherwise could have created a lot of damage and a lot of loss. More broadly, in this idea of situational or environmental awareness, we've also been thinking about how this sort of technology, how this smart sensor technology applies to the things that we're trying to manage and report on nowadays. In this case, for example, the United Nations 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And because we can measure and report and collect data, this is probably the Latrobe Valley Environment Information Network is probably the biggest environmental data collection network in the world. Currently, been operating for 2 years. The amount of data we've collected, if you consider the video and the thermal imagery, which is still available, is really quite amazing. But it gives you long-term insights into the things that hitherto we've been unable to record the data for. Importantly, it's available already on app. So we know people in Latrobe Valley. There's a lady down there who uses her app to put her washing out. The ambulance guys, we know if they get a call from somewhere in that region, they'll check the data because they say this may be a call out for a respiratory illness, but we've got some data beforehand, so it enables them to prepare. And people are using this in that community. It's giving them confidence, particularly after the Hazelwood mine fire, giving them confidence about what's going on around them. They've got their own level of environmental awareness, which is really important to those communities. And you can get the video, you can get any of those parameters, you can watch the rain falling or whatever you like. In terms of how it's being assessed and looked at, the final report of the New South Wales Bushfire Inquiry, in fact, came to the same, here's one we prepared earlier opportunity, and identified the Latrobe Valley Information Network and Attentis Networks as a really short-term opportunity, and saying that not all remote sensing technology requires satellites and expensive drones. This sort of stuff can be set up very quickly and provide situational awareness for a range of purposes. And it's gave the example that I've just presented to you. Also, we've got a good run, Cameron McKenna. Cameron will be online to answer any more technical questions. I'm a director of the company, I should say, but Cameron will be available to answer some questions for you more technically. He was an expert witness in the Royal Commission into Natural Disaster Arrangements as well. And again, they identified the value of Attentis in that. And we're looking forward, perhaps, to working with the Victorian government as they prepare for forthcoming fire seasons as well, because there's no doubt that this technology does give us an extra level of preparedness. It's one of the very, very few early warning technologies available that would alert us in the case of ignition at a range of locations around the state. That's where I'll finish, Mike. Back to you.